an associate professor who does all kinds of interesting things, including social media research, research on health literacy. He's in the Department of Advertising. I don't know if there's anything else I should be saying. He publishes lots of stuff in cool journals that run the gamut of health and communication and advertising. So thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, you know, it is great to be here, actually. I was at lunch with Bree. It was like, oh my God, we definitely should have left like 10 minutes ago. So she was driving here like a crazy person and just kind of threw me out of the car to get in here. So it is awesome to be back here in wonderful East Lansing, Michigan. For those of you who didn't know, I was here, I got a BS in chemistry in 2001. MA in telecom in 2003, and then PhD in mass media in 2006. So I got to spend roughly a decade of my life in wonderful East Lansing, so it's always nice to come back. But what I'm doing now is really, really different from everything that I did when I was here. So, and let's see if we can do this. So what I want to talk about was, one, really quickly explain in the briefest possible terms what health literacy is, and kind of, because it reflects the work I was first doing when I got to Austin, but then talk more about what I've been doing since, which is the idea of kind of how do we layer more effective, compelling messages on top of things that are just sort of clear and simple. So when I talk about, actually kind of, this is my Michigan State life actually, was I worked for Pam Whitten. As a grad student for 5 years, I came to the telecom department thinking I wanted to work like what Chip Seinfeld was doing. Like, I came thinking that was who I was going to be, and I got here and Pam and Chip co-hired me as a grad student. And Pam and Chip being who they were, Pam gave me 30 hours a week for the 10 hours she, like, were hers, and then Chip gave me 5 hours a week for the 10 hours that was meant to be Chip's. And so I got really, really deep, really quickly into telemedicine. And so my first project, I was working on delivering hospice care by video phone. And I was hooked from the very first project, like talking to hospice patients and how healthcare by video phone could make their lives better as hospice patients was really interesting and extremely rewarding and just fun. And so the screenshots on the right are from the very last project I worked on when I was here. And it started life as a thing, which is how can we build websites for people who can't read and maybe have never touched a computer before? And so these definitely do look like they're 15 years old at this point. It would look a little different if you built them now. But they were delivered all of the important diabetes education through audio-visual means. And so if you could sort of work a mouse, which we can teach people how to use a mouse, some people, and kind of very simple VCR-style controls, we could get them really good education about diabetes. And so when I made the transition down to UT, I was really stuck because I was talking to Ashley and I told her, I gave what is without a doubt the single weirdest job talk in the history of my department, because everyone interviews in advertising does a talk on persuasion or branding or whatever advertising-y things they study might be. I did mine on a school-based telemedicine system in Kansas. Like, nothing to do with advertising whatsoever, but it was what I had to talk about. And so I arrived in Austin in a really great school of advertising, had never taught advertising, never studied it, never walked inside an ad agency. And so I really had to figure out, like, what is the thing I was going to study in my life in Austin? And I realized that what made that very first, or that last project my favorite, wasn't really the website, it was the population and the communication challenge of how do we make things as clear and simple and worthwhile as possible to people who maybe struggle with health information. And so I put up here, this is the definition of health literacy I tend to reference a lot. One of the major challenges in the field is there are a trillion definitions of what health literacy might be. I rely on this Berkman definition, which is a slight adaptation of an old Institute of Medicine definition. And the piece about it I like is where it talks about through which individuals can obtain, process, understand, and communicate about health-related information. And the "and communicate about" was the new piece they added when they reviewed a whole bunch of definitions of health literacy. And I think living in a college of communication, that's an addition to the definition that made an awful lot of sense. And so when I first got to UT, again, not really knowing anything about advertising, never having thought about health literacy outside the context of that one project, it was like, well, what the heck exactly do I want to do here? And the really easy thing to think about aiming for was a lot of work at the time was focused on making things that were clear and simple. Like, that's sort of where the field was. I was like, this is a thing I can do. And so people were doing content analysis of drug ads and looking at the reading level of different pieces of them. It'd be like, all the main copy is at an 8th grade level, but all the fair balance is at a 47th grade level. This is clearly evil ad agencies trying to trick people, which isn't really the case, but that's sort of where we are. And so there were all these kind of interpersonal guidelines for clear communication. And when I talk to outside groups, like I did a talk like this at MD Anderson, and people get, for the most part, like these guidelines of how do you communicate more effectively orally, or writing tips. One of them being relevant images to support written materials. This is one I do hassle medical people about a lot, because they understand there should be pictures there. They tend to think of pictures as something to break up the text. And that diabetes thing I showed you guys, we had an icon that was part of it. So there was a section called Signs and Symptoms, and the MSU designer made it a traffic sign. Because he thought, well, people know what a traffic sign is. That's a good icon for a section on signs and symptoms. And one of the MDs on the project, who was sort of a diabetes expert, was adamant that the icon should be a pancreas. Like, no one knows what a pancreas looks like, especially the people we're aiming this intervention at. But he was positive that everyone knows what a pancreas looks like. And so the poor designer had to build like a little cartoon pancreas as the icon for that section. And all the pilot testers were like, why is there a picture of a sponge here exactly? And so we got sort of the reaction that people in communication are like, well, of course that was a terrible idea. But we needed that evidence to go back to the MD and be like, okay, we were kind of right. Can we please go back to what we're pretty sure the right idea was? And so I always kind of want to highlight that one specific thing. The other thing I note here is if you look at those guidelines, it's basically Wikipedia. And we've done studies that look at where do people go online for health information with a lower health literate kind of population. And one thing they talk about a lot is they purposely avoid anything from a .gov or .edu website, because they've learned through time that everything on that kind of website is written at much too high of a reading level. But they love Wikipedia because it follows these really good guidelines. And there's other reasons Wikipedia is obviously not a great health resource. But stylistically, it does a very good job matching sort of the reading level and the structure that works for them. So, you know, we want to try and convert medical language into plain language. We did a study quite a few years ago where we were revising consent documents in Texas. Texas is not very often in, like, the lead on issues related to health in the country.
No.
But it's a shock, right? But informed consent is actually one of them. And so they have this panel that is intended to develop Texas-wide informed consent documents, because people were successfully suing, being like, yeah, I signed that thing because I had to get surgery, but I didn't understand at all what it meant. People would sue successfully. And so we did things like, and we did a whole series of experimental studies looking at this that one of my colleagues led. And so on the old form, it said, like, it's been explained to me as acute myocardial infarction or heart attack. And we put that in front of people, and they thought, I have two conditions? Like, they meant the or heart attack to be clarifying. It actually made it more complicated, because people thought they had two things now. In doing this study, we also had, like, an actual informed consent document, which is always, like, this super long, horrible, dense thing. For the experimental study, we actually put horizontal lines across the document in different places, because we wanted the person to read a paragraph, see a line, and then look up and talk to the grad student who was doing the study. And we'd be like, what did you hate about these documents? And it was like, everything. And we said, is there anything about this document that you liked? A bunch of them were like, those horizontal lines were awesome. We added those for the study. Those weren't really part. But what people talked about is that was their permission to take a break and think about what they were reading. And so it gets that value of sort of white space and trying to build things that actually look like they aren't going to be awful to use. I also, in my first few years in Austin, partnered with a literacy group that did trainings of healthcare providers to make them better at this. And one of the most consistent, interesting findings to us was I added an item to the post-test, which was I originally overestimated my knowledge of health literacy and clear communication, and it was like a 6.7 out of 7. Like, people showed up thinking they knew this really well, and the group does a very, very good training, and then they were like, oh, there's a lot of stuff that I did not know. And so it pointed, I think, at the time, to the fact that providers really overestimate their competency in communication, which I would argue is still the case in a lot of ways. So I spent my first 5-6 years at UT doing a lot of that kind of work. And when I had the chance to sort of get tenure and reframe myself a little bit and figure out, like, what do I really want to do next? Again, having never taught, studied, or lived in an ad agency, my teaching, which has been mainly account planning and campaigns sort of classes, really altered the way I thought about my own research. And so that diabetes thing was really grounded in the idea of being like, well, if only we can make this information really easy to access, of course then people will make smart health decisions, which is a sort of stupid way to think about health promotion. And so living in an ad agency or living in an advertising department where my students never cared if anyone knew at all why they did anything, you just want to persuade them, it helped me think about kind of what's the right balance between persuasion and education to get people to sort of pursue health promotion. And so this really came to the fore for me. I was doing these studies of drug ads when I first got there. And people, if you ask them what they don't like about drug ads, always one of the top couple things is, well, you're using emotional appeals to go get people to demand a drug from the doctor. Which, okay, like, that's a legitimate concern. But this ARC campaign called Real Men Wear Gowns, which the text is too small to read, I promise you there's not one bit of education happening in that ad. It is a pure emotional appeal at middle-aged guys to go get a preventive health checkup so you can be there for the father-daughter dance when your daughter gets married. And it's also a message probably to that guy's wife and to his daughter and so on. But no one complains about that. And so I was like, well, wait a minute. Like, maybe we should stop letting what we don't like about the profit motive of drug advertising color how we can learn from them. They have very large budgets. They spend a lot of money figuring out ways to do this better. We need to get better at stealing from them and applying that to health and health promotion. And also, too, there's a lot of things where education just really isn't the answer. And so I'll prove that to you guys right now, which is to say, if you could please raise your hands for me, if the last time you went to the bathroom, you washed your hands. Okay. See, you're laughing. I know I'd be willing to bet a lot that there's someone in this room who didn't. Because the number in the average population is like 2 out of 5 people. As you're like, I want to move away from you a little bit. The number in the country is 2 out of 5 people don't wash their hands after they go to the bathroom.
Gross.
Yes, it is gross. And so I heard about this in my account planning class. I always partner with the university health office, and I let them pick a topic. And then my students work on that. And I heard this thing about, I was like, that is just a mortifying number. And so my students all worked on it. They had ideas that were very kind of, I would argue for ad students, kind of traditional public healthy. Like, it wasn't the way my students usually approach it. It was very like, stay healthy. And like, I don't fundamentally believe that that last 40% isn't doing it because they don't know that it's the more hygienic thing to do to wash your hands. So we need other levers to pull if we're going to get them to wash their hands. And so I showed this to one of my undergrads. She's like, oh, well, the right answer is you should put something inside my stall door when I'm in the women's bathroom that says, is the girl in the stall next to you going to wash her hands? It's like, because then I'm going to wonder, does it say that in the stall next to me? Because she's like, it's prompting me to be reminded of that social judgment associated with not washing your hands. And like, that might be a lever we could try and pull to get people to change their behavior. And for the record, like, this is a small group, like, you might actually all have washed your hands. But I did that once with like 400 pharmacists at a conference, and all 400 people raised their hands, because no one has ever not raised their hand when I've done this. But there was a guy who was sitting where you're sitting, who I knew hadn't washed his hands because I'd gone to the restroom before my talk. And I saw this guy like go from the urinal like right out the door, and he planted himself. He was right in the front row. And he just puts his hand up like, I sure did. You, sir! Like, I didn't think it'd be appropriate to call him out in front of 399 colleagues, but I wanted to be like, that guy right there is lying right now.
What a shame, though. Is it also possible that people think they wash their hands and they don't?
Well,
is it a behavior that we do sort of on automatic or don't put on?
Well, one thing we learned from doing this is that there's a lot of people who, like, almost always wash their hands, but then if you ask them, like, they'll be like, well, that one time I was running late to an exam, and like, so people will, like, very occasionally skip, or that's what they'll say, at least. And at least at UT, I don't know what any campaigns are like this year, they like they run like this like really basic CDC hand hygiene thing.
Yeah.
It's stickers that are in the mirrors above the sinks. Like, no one's ever going to see that if you weren't already washing your hands at the sink anyway. And so we actually built exactly what that student asked us to build. And so we hung up signs kind of around the communication building, which was that 2 out of 5 people don't wash their hands. One of the benefits I've learned of living in our department, and I'm sure this department too, is you have really good art director copywriter students who can build things for you. And so they built this campaign where the girl's laptop is photoshopped to look like a toilet seat lid, and the guy at the top is drinking a coffee mug that has a toilet seat on top. And then on the right, we hung those posters up above all of the urinals and inside all the restrooms in the building. And 2 super unfortunate graduate students had to hide inside those bathroom stalls for 30 hours. So they did 10 hours baseline, 10 hours week 2, 10 hours week 4. Because even on an online anonymous survey, people lie. And so we needed observational behavior. We learned that there were some people, like, first of all, UT is not really 2 out of 5. It was like 90% at baseline, which was good for public health, but terrible for our research project because it was a very small change we were going to try and make. And some people would rinse their hands, and now we got an uptick in people using soap. So some people wash their hands, they just do it wrong or sort of don't do it really well. But I was given a talk about this, and there was a woman there who worked at the local trauma hospital. And she's like, you know, at our hospital, we're always struggling with hand hygiene. And I've never thought, I was like, well, that's not what I want to hear. Like the way she phrased it, like, really struggling with hand hygiene. Like, that's a terrible thing to hear about the local trauma hospital. But then when I thought about it, it's like, oh, because those people need to wash their hands like a billion times a day. And so we did this exact same process because all the stuff in the hospital were very, like, stop the spread of germs, right? And so we went in and interviewed a bunch of providers to find out why they wash their hands. And are there any deviations from the protocol that they know and understand, which they do anyway? And so one thing we learned is the different people had different reasons for washing their hands. So one person said it was to keep themselves healthy. One person said it was to keep their patients safe. And a third person, or a third answer, was, I want to keep my family at home safe. And the protocol violation we learned about, which was super interesting, is you leave a patient's room, you're supposed to wash your hands before you leave the room. And a bunch of people said they purposely didn't do that, because they thought it would make their patients feel bad. It's like, that my doctor, my nurse thinks I'm so sick and dirty, they have to wash their hands before they leave the room. So they would leave the room and then wash their hands, but that's wrong. And so we built a campaign called Clean Hands Protect. Take time, save lives. One of the ideas being, you can look at that poster and it's like, protects you, protects you, protects everyone being the really important part. So I don't care whether you're doing it because it's for you or your patient or your family at home, like, you can read this however you want to and take away what we want you to. And the one on the right was the thank you for washing your hands before leaving this room, which we hung up inside patient doors. And so providers knew, my patient knows why I'm doing this. It's not because they think I'm horrible and dirty. And like, I know, these providers know why they're supposed to do things, but knowledge is simply not enough. And so we did these observational studies in 2 different hospitals, and in both cases we got more providers to wash their hands, which was attributed pretty much entirely to the nursing population. Physicians are a much harder population to crack and get them to change their behavior, as anyone who's ever worked near a hospital knows, or seen a doctor, for that matter. One of the things that I particularly love about the kind of work I get to do is health literacy and health comm at UT means I get to make up an excuse to work on literally interesting, I think, like, anything I think is interesting, I can probably make work for me. And so we've done work in multivitamin promotion aimed at Hispanic adolescents, because, like, to get the full benefits of folic acid for prenatal health, you need the folic acid for months before you become pregnant, but half of all pregnancies are unplanned. And if you look at the way the CDC promotes, it's like, have a healthy baby, take this prenatal vitamin, which means you're basically missing half the US, like half the women who might become pregnant, because they aren't actually trying to become pregnant, so they ignore all messages. The one on the top, one of the local clinics had a thing where they were trying to struggle with gestational weight gain and breastfeeding promotion. And if you think about the way people who would take kind of a clear and simple approach to health literacy, it's always like, break it down into the stuff you need to know right now. So during pregnancy, like, we're really going to make sure you know gestational weight gain and how much you should be gaining, and like treat that as a separate problem from breastfeeding. But those two things are really conceptually linked, because if there's a woman who's purposely not gaining weight because she doesn't want to lose it afterwards, like, that's the thing that happens. If she understood how many calories you burn and the benefits of breastfeeding, we might actually be able to kind of get both those things to that woman and help her have stronger intentions to do both things the way public health people would want them to do. So we sort of went backwards from the way a lot of people would treat that clear and simple thing, health literacy. It kind of worked. This is an e-cigarette awareness campaign that we worked on, because people don't know what's in the vapor. And so one of the visuals that we came up with was like, this is a chocolate that has mustard inside. There's a cupcake, there's a cupcake that has ketchup. There's all these visual things that people found to be really interesting and engaging in a way to get them to pay attention to what they would probably find to be the relatively boring, like, here's what's in e-cig vapor message that we wanted them to pay attention to. It's not just water. And the top right was a campaign designed around NAP promotion at UT. And the public health people were like, the more sleep among college students is really tightly linked to better health and better grades. And public health people almost always want to approach that as a, let's get you to have more sleep at night. Like, get an earlier bedtime, sleep later in the day if you can. Like, that's how they tend to approach it. I've gotten yelled at several conferences where I talked about this, because we made it a nap promotion campaign. College students like to nap. If we can encourage you to take another nap, it's a way of building up your sleep in a way that I think you might actually do it. And so it was this whole superhero-based thing. There was an online nap map, which if Michigan State doesn't have one of these, you should totally steal and talk to someone at Olin and make this happen. There is a map you can go to on the Texas website, which will show you all of the student-generated best places on campus to take a nap. And so if you want to take a nap at UT, you can go find the closest location. It's like Yelp for nap locations at UT, which we stole from UC San Diego or somewhere. Like, we weren't.
Why nobody told me that?
I know, right? Like, it was, we need one of these everywhere, and one for faculty probably wouldn't be the worst thing either. The other thing that I've been, like, so that's kind of what I've been doing. Now, in terms of what I'm doing right now, the number one thing I think that I think about more than almost anything is how to get guys involved in prenatal health promotion. So the first time my wife found out she was pregnant, I downloaded the My Pregnancy Today app from my phone, because I'm me. And, you know, you put in the due date, and you put in whatever, and it starts doing, like, this week your baby is as big as a grape, and, like, it starts giving you all this information, and there's pieces of it that are really well done. Like, this is what it looks like. There's all these graphics of what's going on, and lots of smiling pregnant women, and here's sort of how things are progressing week by week. But there are moments where even the things that are done well suffer a little bit. So you're pretty far in, and this thing pops up, and it said, I still remember when this came out, it was like, your baby is the size of Swiss chard. It's like, I watch a lot of Chopped. I don't know what the hell Swiss chard is. And so I had to go Google to be like, what is Swiss chard? This is the least helpful parallel you could have offered me. And this is the visual they show you. Which, yeah, that's not the best either. And then, I'm apparently not the first person to wonder this, because as we were doing work on this, there was some kind of mom parenting blog where she's really mad because Swiss chard is light, and thus not a good parallel for how that baby felt at that particular moment to her. And so she just kind of didn't like the parallel on size. But the thing is that even as I was looking at that, as a communication person, it would occasionally say things like, this week your uterus is doing whatever. I was like, no, app, like, this week my uterus is not doing much of anything. And so there were all these moments where I had to sort of look past the fact that this was so obviously aimed at my wife and not at me. And the content was good enough, I was willing to ignore these things as they happened, but as a communication person, it was super annoying. And again, as a country, we've basically managed to ignore half the US population who should be engaged and care about prenatal health. There is a ton of research in developing countries that if you get dads involved, better outcomes for baby, better outcomes for mom. And so this was like this thing I wanted to work on. So we went out and did a bunch of research. We loaded that app up on a tablet and showed it to a whole bunch of dads of various levels of literacy, various everything we could possibly come up with. And a couple of things we learned that were really interesting. One, they were very clear about, is their entire life is nothing but smiling pregnant women and babies. Like, everything they get from all of their provider team looks like that lady at the top right. They were like, please no more of that. That was really clear. But they were super interested and engaged in the topic because they feel like even when they go to these doctor visits, usually they are treated like a pretty nice piece of furniture and the providers don't engage them. Like, I know in my own experience, I would talk to the OB and he was always like, oh my God, that one talks. Like, it was, they were surprised. And so, and there's a lot of published literature about guys in those situations. So we built what we called the Men's Pregnancy Playbook. And so I had a really good former design student who adopted the little icons from like bathroom stalls as a way of when we need to show a human, we use those icons because it is not a smiling pregnant person. And we've shown this to a bunch of guys. We have a qualitative paper that's already published, a quantitative paper with a big national survey that's in production, and hopefully we'll go to a journal over the break. See how that goes. The existing app always likens everything to food. So we built the food version of that your baby's as big as thing to show guys. But one of the guys on the team is like this EdSite guy who does a lot of like men's health, fatherhood issues. And he's like, let's try a sports theme. Just to see what it's like. Like, who knows if we're right, but like, you can imagine a guy being like, your baby's as big as a golf ball, as more relevant to guys. And we ran our test, and guys very much prefer the food-based option, which, okay, the reason they give is that the food stuff helps reinforce the importance of nutrition while a woman's pregnant. It's like, way to go, dude. It's like, that's not all the answer we were expecting from a bunch of guys about this question. So they, we were our expectations were very much exceeded. But we also include content that no guy would ever get on that app that I had. So I remember when my wife was pregnant the first time, also I was like, why do my clothes not fit right anymore? Like, this is kind of annoying. And I went on PubMed and found an article, which is like, the average guy gains like 10 pounds while his partner is pregnant without meaning to. This isn't like the guy who's gaining weight to be supportive. This is like, oops, my pants don't fit right anymore. And so we added a section that is dedicated to like how men's bodies change during pregnancy. And we, right now we're working on, there's a financial planning tool here. The content in this version was all static. Like, you could get through this in about 15 minutes. And one of the things, because that's all we had the money to build at first. And we had to prove it was right before we should spend a lot of money making it big and fancy. And across the board, all these guys said, when you build your first interactive tool, I would like some kind of financial calculator, because that is a thing as a guy I feel like I can have a little bit more control over, I can be a little bit more helpful and involved. And so what we're currently doing is building that exact tool for a web-based version that would let a guy be like, my partner and I are pretty bare bones, we'll take the basics, we're kind of average, or we need diamond encrusted everything. So like, add a couple levels of how nice your stuff needs to be, and then let people go in and check boxes what they're gonna need, put in your monthly income, put in your due date, and it will go back to you and say, it's gonna cost you about $400 a month to have all the stuff you need when your baby shows up. And so that's gonna be built before the year is up, because my money expires on December 31st. And that's the next thing that we're gonna start testing to see if guys react to that the way they sure seem to indicate they would want to react to that if we put it in front of them. Longer term though, the goal is to build the app that can live on a guy's phone and be kind of a platform for health promotion and research. Like, I know a lot of people at UT who would love to build a 10-minute, 5-minute content module and two questions afterwards. Like, the state of Texas, and I think probably a lot of states do this, when they do try to involve dads in prenatal health, it's a lot of, there's like 14 red flags here, we're going to try to make you not be a total disaster as a dad. And what we're trying to move the state toward is, actually, if we just made fatherhood and good fatherhood a norm, we can raise all boats at once. And so there's a lot of people at UT, I think, that we can get involved in kind of, this is a research kind of platform for a lot of health promotion and work going on in Texas related to maternal and child health. And again, because for 5-6 years, I sort of ignored my e-health background because I wanted to get promoted to make sense in my department. On the other side of tenure, now that I can do whatever I want, I'm back to thinking about technology and e-health and things that make were what I originally came to grad school to study in the first place. And so, you know, when I was here as an undergrad, probably, was when all that like original digital divide stuff was like, that research was really coming out. And that seems to have faded away in a lot of ways. And so we were interested in sort of to what degree are people's health literacy and ability to really engage with complicated health information, how might that be changing the way people engage with patient portals from their providers, all the wearable technology we have, like Fitbits and smartwatches and stuff, and mobile apps related to health. I'm not going to get into every nitty-gritty detail of this, because the article's already published and you can go grab it. Although that's really hard to read, but I swear it's a JMIR right now. The two things from this study that I was most excited about, because a lot of work with low health literate audiences tends to be pretty small sample, because it is hard to find a lot of people who can't read well. Like, this is not easy. This was a nationally representative survey recruited to be like representative in terms of SES and gender and so on and so forth. The two findings we found that I was personally most excited about was one, the fact that kind of lower health literate populations or scoring lower on one of the established health literacy measures meant you were less likely to trust information from government sources in general. Which is good, well not, it's not good to be clear, but it confirmed like some qualitative data we'd had from like 8-9 years ago, but we had no proof. It was like 50 people in a focus group, like a series of focus groups. I'm like, I don't really know if I trust this across the entire country, but that really popped up. And when you think about work to get people to adopt health IT for their benefit, thinking hard about who the right source is gonna be extremely important. The other thing is, one of my co-authors, this was really driven by, we were working with a private practice in Austin, and a bunch of people would sign up for their patient portal and then never use it again. Like, they'd sign up, log in, be like, this looks horrible, and go away. And they were like, we need to understand all these one-time signups if we want to make this tool work for our patients. And the thing we learned, because she's sort of a visual communication person, is perceived ease of use from like technology acceptance model kind of thinking was catastrophic for that particular patient portal. And across our study here, lower health literate individuals in our sample were less likely to find all of these kind of tools easy to use and useful to them. And making them seem useful seems like a much harder problem to solve. Making things look better and behave the way you expect a thing to behave and be visually more engaging, I think, is a much easier first problem to solve. And so I've been interviewed about this paper a bunch of times when it went live, and every single time I was like, what's the most important thing for people doing this in real world? I'm like, make your stuff look good and understand these best practices for developing visual things, because no one, I mean, it's been like 15 years now, no one has ever said, can you please give me something that is more complicated and harder to use? Like, so even people who are super health literate, like, you'd rather use a thing developed in this room that looks nice and is easy to use than is not. Like, this isn't rocket science. And so the degree which we can raise awareness of that as the way to get more people involved using these tools and getting the full benefits, I think is the much easier way to solve that problem. I was reading something, I think it was one of the readings actually Serena gave me when I was planning my intro theory seminar for our PhD students. There was something you gave me that included this quote from Paul Lazarsfeld where he was talking about his research agenda. And one of, like, it's like people are like, what do you do at UT exactly? Like, I spend a lot of time working on random, seemingly random projects that emerge because there's a new faculty member at Del Med who wants to study online decision aids for hand surgery, and then my interpersonal friend wants to look at how to the providers do that conversation in person. Like, all these random things come together. It's like, oh, this is a really cool project that can solve a real world problem. And so I've been thinking a lot about kind of what I'm doing next, and part of it is continuing this work with the men in prenatal thing. Like, I'm going to find the money and secure the money to build that thing if it kills me. You have a question.
Well, I mean, I'm one of the people that I know from grad school named Sue Mello, and she does a lot of stuff not on prenatal health per se, but instead on sort of preconception risks. So, like, you know, women shouldn't binge drink when they're trying to get pregnant. But one of the things that's really interesting to me in that context is that there's often the things that men should also not do, preconception, to reduce the risk of their children having certain types of outcomes.
Right.
How is that? I mean, I know that this, so I've been sitting here thinking, but that's not really prenatal health, but it's in some ways a very related topic.
I mean, I can't give like, when I am asked in Texas to go give talks to various health professional groups, like, I always end up showing that app and talking about kind of the thinking that led to it. Because the lessons learned are much broader than just, like, people who care about that.
Right.
But I can't show it and not have three people run up and tell me content they want guys to know.
Right.
Like, it doesn't matter what I'm there to talk about, like, cancer, whatever. And,
right.
and I've never heard this specific one before. But, like, I was talking, the woman from the LBJ policy, or public affairs program in UT, came up, and she's like, you need to include a thing in there, because we built it very much in our heads with, like, mom and dad are a team, and they're going to have this baby together. And she's like, you need a thing, a module that is specifically about parental and, like, father's legal rights. She's like, we know from her, like, from her research that if a dad is not there to get a paternity test, if he needs it, like, when the baby is born in the hospital, that test isn't happening. And so she wants that to be a thing. And I showed it to another OB in town, and she's like, you need to add all the stuff about contraception. Because new moms get information about contraception. Dads do not get that. And so I would say that there's an office in Texas, in kind of the state health services, it's pretty new, that is funded specifically to fund evidence-based interventions around getting dads involved in, like, being good dads. And the one who runs it, though, is like, if only there was an evidence base. Like, there's a lot of, like, and so the office has agreed to fund research that could build that evidence base. I'm positive this is the kind of thing they would want to be part of that. And there's a guy in UT Medical Branch in Galveston who, one of his statistical things that he's trying to figure out, like, in terms of risk, is he said in their practice they struggle a lot with, one, stats in general, right? Like, there's a 1 in 1,000 chance of this thing happening, and people are...
Like, what does that mean?
Yeah, people are just terrible at that in general. And he says what makes his life particularly challenging compared to, like, his oncologist friends is a lot of times, like, if we do this thing for you, there's a 1 in 1,000 chance this thing happens to you, but then it's a 1 in 10,000 chance this happens to the baby. And so it's like they're, like, throwing complicated stats at people, and it's not just for them. Now it's, like, people in their heads trying to wrangle with unlikely events for mom and for baby, and it's like this extra... horrible, complicated mess that I want to, like, I'm planning projects, hopefully starting this coming year, with him for that reason. And so I don't, you're right, that I don't know that the, like, I don't know many people, like, I care about stuff like this. I never would have installed an app like this on my phone, like, before we were pregnant, probably, but there's other ways, maybe, to get that information out.
Yeah, and I know that's sort of off topic from what you're saying, but I was just sitting thinking about this, because I just talked to Sue about it this morning.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is one of the reasons I love giving talks like this, like, and we were talking about this a little bit this morning, like, giving talks to people who do work in public health or medicine, some of the things that seem so obvious to us in communication are just earth-shattering to them. Like, there was a PhD student in nursing who I met my first year or two at UT, and she was like, she came up, she's like, did you see the article written by so? I have no idea what you're talking about. And she's like, it was a nursing researcher, and this person found that if they targeted their intervention for whatever it was, based on gender, there were better outcomes. And I was like, as a communication person, I'm like, so you just, they rediscovered in nursing the idea of targeting based on gender. And I was like, well, I'll tell you that in advertising and communication, we can go a little further than targeting based on gender. And so we talked about what that might look like. But even the idea of, like, the folic acid promotion stuff. One of the posters, it's a blue poster, and it's like, I forget what the copy is. There's four pictures. And it's like, healthy looking lady, who's in, like, gym clothes. And then it shows her getting married. The third panel is her, like taking a prenatal vitamin, like she's in front of her medicine cabinet, clearly taking this medicine. And the fourth thing is a baby. It's like, this, out of all the people in the world who need this message, the super planned, like, I did everything perfectly lady is not that person.
Well, and it's also sort of normative in a way that would suggest that maybe, like, I mean, there's all kinds of negative outcomes for people that you really care about.
Right, and so, but then when I, like, you know, this is also why I like doing my work where I get to do it, but, like, the thing we built here then was intended to promote folic acid to the kind of that audience. We were aiming at basically high school age Hispanic females. Like, that was the target. We wanted to start a daily multivitamin. Because a daily multivitamin has the folic acid I want her to have for public health reasons, whether she plans on getting pregnant or not. And so it was like, You Got Lucky was the ad target. Like, we entirely stole Gardasil's wellness campaign. Like, so we aimed one thing at the mom, which is like, and none of the moms we talked to knew about folic acid for her own first pregnancy. but they all knew about it for the second one. And so we're like, why do we keep trying to fight this fight with every new generation of women who are having babies? Why don't we rely on mom's knowledge to get her to want to start her daughter on a multivitamin? But we don't really talk about birth defects a lot because the age, like, the mom we're aiming at does not want to think about her daughter having sex yet. And then we aim the one at the girl herself. What's her secret? I use my ed class as like a laboratory for this. I cannot do this. If I throw 50 advertising students at this for 3 hours, every single semester, they will tell me the answer is, what's her secret? Like, they've actually come up with that copy independently, repeatedly. The idea being sort of a really admirably awesome high school age girl who is like stronger bones, really athletic, has great hair and nails, like all these benefits they can tie to a daily multivitamin. She's not so perfect, but she's annoying. But like, basically, like, that's the way to get a high school age girl started on multivitamin, as my all of my undergrads will tell me every single year when I use this as an in-class exercise. But when I do this to public health people, they get really mad at me. Because they say, this is a prenatal health promotion campaign, and you're not making that obvious. And it should be more obvious to people, like, what your end goal is. And my right back is, if I did that, then they'd ignore me. So it's like this weird thing where in communication we would maybe have one perspective on this. Like, I'm not lying to anyone, but I'm sort of strategically omitting, like, one, like, the real benefit that we ultimately care about, because it would make everyone involved ignore us. So, you know, everyone has different views on this. The other thing that I'm be working on a lot, and that I just love to talk to you all, is the stigma associated with health literacy. And so, because of where I live and what I do now, so right now I'm basically running our Center for Health Communication, because our actual director also happens to be our dean. Those are both more than full-time jobs, so he refers to himself as the nominal Health Comm Center Director. But it's a really cool opportunity, because right now in Austin, UT Dell Medical School is open for business. And so they are trying to really radically rethink the way they're training future providers. Like, I was part of a group that sat down with them, and we worked to figure out all the ways that evidence-based health communication could be woven into their communication curriculum. So, like, let's not tell students, like, you have to learn from your mentor the best way to break bad news. Like, no, like, people have studied this. Like, there are objectively better or more terrible ways to break bad news. We're gonna teach you the best way to do this. But what it means is that I have access to all of these pretty forward-thinking providers, and I wanna work with them on how they are training all of their med students, but then also all the social workers on campus and the nursing students to understand issues related to communication, health literacy, the stigma associated with low health literacy, because this is not a thing people want to admit to their providers. And then how can we train students to be resilient? So the med school is the most common group that talks about this. They want to do things differently. One of their biggest problems is they know that they are going to send students out to their residencies with a bunch of people who don't think like the Dell Med faculty. And so they're always really thinking very hard about how can they train their students to do it the way they're trained kind of in the classroom and the way that Dell Med wants them to behave and be better physicians in the world, when they're gonna go out in the real world and this person's gonna be like, that's the way those crazy UT people do it. Like, here's how we actually do this thing. And so they're putting a lot of time and effort into thinking about how you build resilient students, which I think matters no matter what your discipline is. Like, I think this applies to like the ad PR students in our program. Like, we wanna teach them to think one way and they're gonna go off an internship, they're gonna go off to their first program. Like, we wanna build people who are leaders for a generation, not people who are going to be awesome Twitter monkeys. So I think if you don't build that resilience in your students, no matter what your field is. So those are a couple things I'll be working on a lot, I hope, in the next couple years. And that's all I got for you guys, other than hopefully a chance to talk, because I've been talking way longer than I normally like to talk. So thank you for having me today. I'd love to answer any questions, talk whatever you want.
So, could you explain to us a little bit more how, when you look at your work, mainly translating sort of things that you know in communications research into for practitioners, right?
Yep.
Which some of your work seems to suggest, or whether it also enables you to create new insights and new theories and new research.
It's funny, I was just talking about this with Serena a little bit this morning, is like, I work with some people who are very like theory-building, theory-driven researchers. That is not who I am. I mean, the work I did here was like building interventions, evaluating what works, and then publishing what works or what doesn't. And so sometimes, like, a lot of the message development campaign stuff that I do, is a lot like that. Like, I'm not building a video conferencing system for hospice care, but I'm taking what we know, things that we know work from kind of persuasion and advertising and communication literature, applying that to solve a health com problem. And like, when I do that kind of stuff, I always try to publish it in the American Journal of Infection Control, or like places the practitioners in those fields are going to read about it. Otherwise, like, what are we doing here? I think the thing that I did related to kind of how people are adopting health IT, that's not super theory driven, but that's much more like, that's a thing people didn't know. Like, that's more new findings on a big scale. So that's not so much translation as like actually building knowledge and evidence in a particular area. I kind of like the translational stuff more as a person. Like, I think that's the most fun stuff I get to work on. And it lets me work a lot with people from other fields. Like, I love my projects the most where it's like, I'm gonna work with these random people who are the experts in their health field and population, and then let's bring our communication expertise to them, do an intervention, and see if we can change people's behavior in a meaningful way.
On the same lines, what do you think that public health scholars are resistant to getting to understanding what you precisely told us?
I'm going
to
slide off camera while I answer this question. I think it's just a difference in training. In part, I mean, I wrote an article, so I showed you that the drug ads that were on that one slide. One of the very first projects I did when I got to UT to kind of build my advertising credibility, I went out and interviewed a bunch of people who work in ad agencies developing drug ads. Because when I looked at drug advertising research, there was a lot about what a providers think, there was a lot about what patients think, there were a lot of studies doing content analyses and readability and all that kind of stuff. No one had ever talked to people who build the drug ads. And so one of the things I learned is they were all super well trained in health literacy and clear communication. Like, they all had seen videos that I use when I'm training my students. And so there was an ad at the time where it was like, talk to your doctor if your family has a history of renal problems. Like, come on, like, no one knows what renal means. But when I talked about that, they said they know the right answer is to say, like, kidney problems. Like, kidney's not medically accurate, but it gets you like 90% of the way there, and people would know if their families have kidney problems. But they can't use that training because of fear of being sued. Like, the pharmaceutical companies themselves and the government sort of make these people worse at their jobs than they're trained to be. No one ever would have known that without talking to them. And like, that points to a policy fix. Like, let's focus on like meaningful fair balance, not stupidly, ridiculously medically accurate fair balance, which then no one understands. Like, that's a bad outcome. And so I actually wrote an article for the American Journal of Public Health, and it was like a letter to the editor, whatever they call it there. And it was like, here's why you should talk to people who work in advertising, because it would improve public health research, practice, and policy. Like, I'm 100% sure that if people who do work in obesity or tobacco control, whatever it is, if you talk to people who design the ads, it will make you better as a field. They desk rejected it within 12 hours, including the 8 hours the editor was asleep. I mean, it's like I sent it at night, and like the next morning I woke up pretty early to a rejection.
So ACPH also always does all their desk rejections within 24 hours. So, I mean, so in context,
yeah.
That's not all that unusual for a paper at AJPH, because they only accept like 8 or 10%.
Yeah. I just took it as a sign. But like, their form letter back is like, we only care about things that would improve public health research and practice and policy. And so I'm not 100% sure exactly where it comes from. Like, I guest lecture, I'm an adjunct in the public health school down the street, and I go to speak to one of their classes every spring, and the students get super excited about the way, like, we in this room would probably talk about health com and public health and the way those things can work together in a way where the students are like, why do we not get more of this in our actual program? And so I don't know if it's just like a thing that as public health people go through programs and they're exposed to more things like this, that gap will go away over time. I don't know. It's,
so when I was at UCSF, we had a whole initiative to improve the quality of the medical students, right? Because UCSF is on the medical school. And the problem was that all the time that they spend on health literacy and on communication interventions is time they're not spending learning how to save lives. Right? So like, if you get a medical student and you know that they're gonna be in a trauma unit and they have to deal with, like, you know, what happens when your spleen ruptures, it's hard to justify to a dean,
because I was part of these meetings, right? So we had fair success doing this, but it was partly, you know, it's UCSF, it's like the most liberal medical school ever. No, I mean, really, it's unusual. But, you know, the trick is to frame it as, if you do this, this many people will not die. And it's really easy with tobacco research, because we have really good statistics on how tobacco affects health outcomes and how that affects things longitudinally and the social costs and all this other stuff, right? And so we had less trouble with that. But the problem for me, I think, is always being able to frame it in a way that lets them see that like less people will die or that the morbidity will be less because of X. And I think that's, and so when you can make that sell, I think they're enthusiastic. I think they're like thrilled, like, oh my God, we're saving people, and we don't have to, you know, this doesn't cost you anything. This costs us $200,000 to make this, you know, pretty website, and that's nothing. So that was my...
Yeah, and that's kind of the public health version. I know, speaking to like actual providers, I also believe that most humans are sort of lazy and selfish. And so I often will, when I'm talking to providers about why they should care, it's a lot of, if you take the extra, like, because teach back is one of like the really good approaches to making sure patients understand. Like, tell back to me the thing I just told you. If they can't, then they didn't know. But that takes time. And so when we're doing talks or doing trainings for providers, like, you know, if you do this right now, it might take you 5 minutes, but you know who you're not going to see in 2 weeks? The same person who comes back because they screwed something up that they could have done appropriately had they actually understood when they left your room. The financial piece matters a lot, too. Hospitals care a lot more now than they did pre-Obamacare, because as their reimbursement is tied to preventable readmissions, like the need to do that education right as people are leaving, like now there's dollars attached to it in a way that also has gotten people to care that didn't previously.
Okay. I have a couple questions. One of the things you mentioned was this idea of creating a shame-free environment. What are like the concepts, and can you tell me a little bit more about that line of research?
Yeah, so one of the things, like, so people really try to hide, like, a health literacy barrier, right? So if the same patient, like, I've worked with a guy named Barry Weiss who built, like, he wrote, like, the AMA manual on, like, health literacy, and he's also, like, the nicest senior person I've ever worked with. Like, he's awesome. And one of the things, like, there's all these tips, like, if the same patient always forgot their glasses, like, that might actually mean they can't read, and they're pretending like they forgot their glasses, so they don't have to admit that in front of you. It's really giving, like, it's a wording change. So I'm not the best at this. My friend who does interpersonal is much better at this. But the way in which they try to train providers to say things less like, is there anything you didn't understand? Because then that's a thing that no one wants to be like, well, yeah, here's lots of things I didn't understand. Like, that's really hard for anyone to do, especially if you don't want to admit you're struggling in the moment. And so they always try to kind of train the people to tweak their language and be like, is there anything you want me to go over again? Or is there anything, like, there's ways of tweaking it to make it more acceptable to say yes and admit they didn't know something if you don't even have the time to do like the teach back where you can like effectively like you really struggle with that. This is again also why I like working with my interpersonal colleagues because they're much better at this than I am. Like, so that's a big piece of it. I also tried to get funding and we were like, not super mad about it. There was a grant in Austin that was like $100,000, but it couldn't go to personnel. So all these nonprofits are like, what the hell do we need? $100,000, like what do we need? $100,000 of stuff. So like 1 year the local food bank applied to like get a new truck to drive around and collect more food. And we were the runner up and our idea was that we should take, like spend our entire $100,000 budget on pads of paper with the Ask Me Three questions from whatever the Ask Me Three campaign was, whoever sponsored that originally, Pfizer or someone, with pencils. And we wanted to put them in the like the waiting room of every clinic in Austin as a sign, like you are supposed to walk in there right now. Here's a pad of paper with three questions, like what's my problem, why does this matter to me, what should I do about it, with like pencils there. And it would give people this permission, like this is an environment in which you are supposed to feel comfortable asking questions. And we were the runner-up, I'm super bummed because I'm positive that would have done something. Okay. So I think that's part of it too.
So do you have advice for our PhD students that you would give them?
Advice in terms of?
During their PhD. While they're getting their PhDs here?
I guess the biggest thing is actually why I always put this quote up here, this patent quote, which I love. I think one of the things that's made me most successful in my career so far is the degree to which I don't think something has to be perfect before it goes to a journal. And so, because at a certain point, like, you're just rearranging deck chair, like, you're making changes that aren't affecting the way the outcome's gonna go when the reviewers look at your paper.
But he's a
submit selected health journals, which are faster.
But even communication journals, I still treat that way, because like there's moments where I work with colleagues where they're like, should this sentence be written this way or this way? And I'm like, it doesn't matter. Like, it needs to go to a journal so reviewers can yell at us about whatever it is they're going to yell at us about, because we're not making fundamental changes to the paper anymore. And so I'm always the first person to get there. And related to that, I also treat a rejection from a journal like it's a rejection, as opposed to a revise and resubmit. So I have colleagues who will be rejected and then like go through major revisions to their article before they send it to the next place. And my general goal is if I was rejected, I get it back to a journal within a week. Because then they have new people who are going to complain about new things, and for all I know, they're going to make me change it back the way it was before. And so I view time and article, like, I mean, I look to see if there's like obvious things where I can like, oh, I can make this change and make this article better. Like, I don't ignore the reviews, but I don't go through like point by point making a billion changes, because I don't, like, reviewing is random enough that killing myself to respond to the first batch of random reviewers to make the next batch of random reviewers success, like, that just doesn't feel like the best use of my time. That's my, I mean, your mileage may vary. I've said that in front of colleagues who I think try to give our PhD students the opposite advice. Because they're like, don't listen to that guy, he's clearly crazy right now. But that's just kind of the way I've operated.
You coming and doing this tonight. This was fantastic.
Oh, this is, anytime I can come back to East Lansing, it's always a good time.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Oh my God, we're freaking out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And thank you for letting me borrow. Sure.
It was very good to see you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's recording.